So I am Ken Edgar, and along with my colleague Arno De Keyser, we're here interviewing today on behalf of the Weston Historical Society, longtime Weston resident Fred Hellerman.
Hi.
Today is April 5th, 2016, and we are sitting in Fred's wonderful living room on Good Hill Road in Weston, Connecticut. Fred, as you'll discover, is one of our more famous residents. As a result of his long career in the arts, he's best known for his singing, his guitar playing, and his songwriting, his movie producing, and several other things that he's lesser known for, but he'll plead guilty to. Fred, it's an honor and a pleasure for us to be with you today and to help you to record your oral history. So thank you for doing it.
Well, you're very welcome. I haven't done it yet.
So let's start at the beginning, Fred. Tell us about where you were born and a bit about your growing up in New York City.
I grew up in Brooklyn, which was a wonderful town. And this was now, by the way, was in the 1930s. I was born in 1927. And it was a great place to grow up in. It was a great town, as history has proven. It's been a great town. My father came to this country from Latvia. My mother was born in Jersey City. My father was in the woolen sweater business. My father had a couple of people working for him who were able to go around to these factories and to take all the remnants of the stuff that was cut, you know, from the patterns, and he put it into burlap bags and bring it over to Williamsburg, where my father had an operation there. And it was a small thing, in a factory-like setting. It only had, there were two or three black women that he had hired. And what they would do all day, they would sit there and they would be sorting out all the fragments that they got by color, by design, all kinds of things that went into it. And all day long, they would sit and listen to the radio. Okay? This is in the 30s. They would listen to the radio. They'd be listening to the popular, they'd be listening to Tommy Dorsey and Benny Goodman and Bing Crosby. And, that was the music that they heard and that they would be hearing all day. And sometimes in the summer times when I would be working for my father, doing all kinds of things, this was the music that I was listening to also. And I didn't think of it. It was the most natural thing in the world. For me, to be listening to it. But that's the music that I grew up with. I say that now because there'll be other things I'm going to have to say.
Right.
And they were very important things in my life. All right, let's go on from that.
Sure.
In the meantime, I went to school I started in kindergarten in Brooklyn, which is, I was on Coney Island, not Coney Island Avenue, on McDonald Avenue in Brooklyn, where the elevator went right by my window there. The fact is, though, that growing up in Brooklyn, I didn't have any friends. I didn't have a friend in the world, or in Brooklyn. And then later I I finally did make a friend. His name was Abby. And he was a painter. He wasn't a musician or anything, but he was a painter, a very good painter. And he was the only friend I had, the guy who I really liked and got, you know, very connected to him. Until I was about, I'm thinking I must have been about 12 or, no, a little more than that, maybe 13 or 14 even. And I remember one Saturday, he couldn't be found. He wasn't anywhere around. And I was determined I had to find him, you know. And so I found him. And I found that he was babysitting. And so that Saturday night, I went there, and I walked into this apartment, a very nice apartment that was there, that he was babysitting at. And while we were, you know, I walked in, and the place was filled with records. There were records all over the place. And, you know, it's playing. And I'm kind of listening to what's going on, and I'm hearing all kinds of things that were very strange coming out of a phonograph record. What I'm hearing is, oh, what is that I, on the record, yeah. What is that I see yonder coming, coming, coming? What is that I see yonder coming, coming, coming? Get on board, get on board. It's that Union train a-coming, coming, coming. It's that Union train a-coming, coming. It's that Union train a-coming, coming, coming. Get on board, get on board, get on board, get on board. What's that? And then there's another record. And it's a song about Jim Crow. And there's another song about, I don't know, something else, but you know, but you get the idea, you know. Join that union, join the thing, you know. If you want higher wages, let me tell you what to do. You got to talk to the workers in the shop with you. You got to feel that the... And if you all get together, boys, it won't be long. You get higher wages. You get better, better conditions. It's like... These are on records. I don't know, what's this all about? Okay, all of that, and how it built a kind of social awareness for me, which, you know, said a great deal. Because remember, I was living in the time in which I'm talking about was the time of the Spanish Civil War, Franco and the, you know, and the. And I remember I was in elementary school at the time, and I remember somebody said to the teacher, you see it here in the papers all the time about all this thing, fighting and going on in Spain. Yeah, well, what's that all about? And now, this was in the early 30s. By the way, I have to tell you my earliest political things I was aware of. One of my earliest memories, and I probably couldn't have been more than 6 or 7 or 8, was hearing Herbert Hoover. No, right. Herbert Hoover, rah, 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 put him in the ash can, ha, ha, ha. Now, this was the early 30s now, right? And, but then I remember this teacher, one of the kids asked the teacher, what's the thing in the Spanish Civil War? And the teacher said, could you imagine if we had an election here and the Democrats won the election, everybody was all in favor of that, and then all the ones who lost in the election, they didn't accept their defeat there, mm-hmm. and so they had, you know, militia come in and take over. And that's what was happening in Spain. Mm-hmm. Spain, and you had the ones who were...
The Republicans and the fascists.
You know, as if it was the Democrats right. and the Republicans and so on.
So how did that affect you?
Well, it affected me in the sense all of a sudden I understood a lot about politics. There was a lot to understand about politics, you know, for a kid.
At that age.
You know, at that age. So I finally understood where... It was just a few years later, for example, when I was a little bit older, I was maybe 16 or 17 by then. No, I wasn't 17 yet. I was earlier than that. So it had to be about, I was 15 or 16. Mm-hmm. And now my father was a wonderful man. I deeply loved him. He really left a mark on me. He was, you know, he had come here from Latvia. And, you know, he made his way into the world, you know, very modestly. And also at that time, in New York City, New York, I was becoming very conscious. Also, in that time, you know, you couldn't help but be conscious. You know, you had wars and you had Hitler coming up and all kinds of things. And, you know, so it was very... And also, I remember on street corners you had all kinds of politicians, you know. It was a very exciting time, you know. I mean, all the bad guys are up there and the good guys and the... You know, anyway, they had, on the city council, they had all kinds of, you know, political people running for office. And one line in all that, the Communist Party had a thing in there. And I said to my father, Dad, who are you voting for in the election? And my father said, you know, I thought about that a lot. And I finally did come up with an answer. What was that? Did you vote for Peter Caccione? I still remember Peter Caccione, who was a wonderful, wonderful, but he was a communist. He ran on the communist ticket. And he said, who are you going to vote for? You know, he said, well, I thought about it very seriously, and I finally decided that even though it was very much against my class interests, I decided I had to vote for Peter Caccione. He's clearly the better guy. Mm-hmm. It brings tears to my eyes when I tell you, it was so moving to me even then. Mm-hmm. You know? And I never got over that.
So that was obviously a big influence.
Oh,
huge influence. So I want to move forward to... your time in the Navy and the Coast Guard, because you're right out of high school, it's the middle of World War II.
What happened was that I was approaching being drafted, you know, at that time, being drafted into the Army, and And I thought, gee, you know, I think I may want to join the Coast Guard instead of joining the Muddy Army. Especially also since my older brother was in the Coast Guard already. So I did that. You know, I did join the Coast Guard. And that was quite an experience. It was quite an experience. Well, number one, it was strange because I joined the Coast Guard and you had to report to boot camp, you know, and I was assigned to Manhattan Beach, Sheepshead Bay. I was immediately put into Morse code. And they were going to make me into a radio operator.
Yes, I remember you told me last time you could still remember the Morse code.
Oh, absolutely.
Right.
Right. My name is Didadadi, Didadadi, Didadadi. Remember it very well. Mm-hmm. I remember the Morse code very well. Well, not very well because I find like sometimes, you know, on radio you hear some weird interference.
Right, right.
You know, with
it turns out they're actually sending you a message.
But I have a hard time.
Well, we don't use it too often now, so it's understandable that you'd lose the ability to remember all.
Well, I can send it. Mm-hmm. I can send it first, mm-hmm. but I can't read it very well. But I used to be, you know, fantastic speeds mm-hmm. with it. But what happened is, you know, so I went through, I remember when I had a report for my first thing in radio school, they sat me down and they said, okay, now you're going to learn the Morse code. A, da-da, B, da-da-da-da, you know, or da-da-da-da, and so on. And I did that for 6 months, and of course, you know, speed it up. I became very, very good. And what was true, though, also was that most of the radio operators were very musically orientated, aside from being musicians, maybe not, but they're all very, you know, well modulated, whatever. So that had, thing on me. But I remember that after I was in the Coast Guard, and now I was assigned to Boston as my next stop. I reported up there after a week or two of leave for that. I reported to Coast Guard headquarters up in Boston. And before they knew it, I was thrown into a car and zap out to the Boston, you know, to the Navy Yard. And they threw me onto the plane, onto the ship. And before I got both feet onto the ship was off and away. They were just sitting there waiting for me. They needed me. They needed a radio operator. And I remember it was, I can't remember what year it was exactly, but I remember it was a day in October. It was a day in October, and it's a beautiful, beautiful, sunny, sunny day. And the water, it was like jello. Not a ripple, not a wave, not a any. I never saw anything like it either before or since. It was an incredible thing I'd ever seen in the ocean. And immediately the first ship, you know, we were out, and we were on our way down to Trinidad, which is going to be the first stop. And after Trinidad, we were going further south. We were going further south to Recife port in Pernambuco, which is part. And when we would come into it, we would be met by a whole string of, you know, small boats, and by by not a very attractive women, and all the way coming in, they'd be there, and they'd be singing and whistling and thing, and you're like, hello, and we ever go ashore every night, you know, or every day, whatever, and we would go ashore, and these girls would come up to us. And they throw their arms around you, and they roll themselves up against you. It's it was like a benediction almost. It's like, Jesus Christ, I love you like crazy, baby. No shit. That was it. that was the benediction. Jesus Christ, I love you like crazy, baby. No shit.
Very romantic.
Yeah, very romantic.
Isn't it romantic?
So can you tell us what you did in the Coast Guard, what yeah. your mission was?
Yeah.
Wasn't top secret at this point?
No. At this point, we would go out. Our patrol would be for 30 days. 30 days in port and 30 days, you know, and it would take us a few days to get out to our station, and we would go there, and we would actually see the ship that we were leaving, which was, you know, very down there in Brazil, and, you know, there was no problem. Other times we were stationed up in. North of that, up to the Arctic Circle. And that was a lot different. That would be in January, February, 30-foot waves, and you'd go out there. And we were in areas where just several months before, one of the Coast Guard ships capsized there. First of all, you'd see the ship that you were leaving, and it was like watching a matchbox in a washing machine. You say, my God, how are we going to survive this? I was never so frightened in my life. And, you know, you'd have to lash yourself into your
chair there.
Chair, your cots,
your bunk.
It was frightening, really frightening. You had to lash yourself out, otherwise you'd just be tossed around in there.
Yeah, I think you mentioned that this a lot of your assignments had to do with the weather and testing the weather.
Oh yeah. No, what happened was that we had it was a ship. The ship we were on was. Well, it was about the size of a destroyer, a relatively short ship, you know, we would see what we were leaving. It was terrifying, really. Yeah, that was the most frightening thing that happened to me in your in the service. That's all I was able to do to us win the war.
So what was your assignment? I think the weather balloons went up and you had to radio?
Oh, yeah. The weather balloon. Oh, yeah. So what would happen was, this was another frightening moment. When we left Boston and this beautiful thing out there, and we were out for maybe for a half hour already, and then someone would come in and hand us some papers and say, "What do we do with this?" They said, "Oh, well, you ship this off, you send this off to Washington, right around, then we give you new weather reports, you know." The weather reports, you know, for the, these was civilian aerographers, sending off these, their readings that they've been supposed to be doing, and it was to send off, you know, all the planes, the U.S. planes that were flying across to England and, you know, supplying them with all kinds of things, and that's what we would be sending off every 15 minutes, you know. But being fresh out of school, one of the first things you learned when you're at sea, you don't open radios, you know, because there's ships around you that are all being torpedoed, and then you're sitting, you can hear them. So that was pretty terrifying when you realize that this is what you were going to be doing. What they told you, though, was that it was really the safest place you could be, because the U-boats, they needed the information just as well, just as much. Yeah, they were listening to everything, but that's what they needed. So it was a perfectly safe place to be. I loved being at sea all that time.
So music. So what was your first instrument that you ever played?
Now, the first instrument that I ever played was the ukulele. I went out and bought a ukulele. And
why did you do that?
I just needed something to, I wanted to learn how to, and then also I learned that the ukulele was tuned, I can't remember the notes now, but it was ba 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 ba. This dog, my dog has fleas. I don't know if that's familiar to you.
I'm more of a guitarist, but yes.
Well, the thing is that ba 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 ba. That's what a guitar.
Okay.
You know, and then I began to figure out, I mean, because that was very easy to, you know, to figure out.
Your chords and things.
Tune, you know? And then aboard ship, we would be out for 30 days at a time. There was a little room there. It was like more like a closet. Nobody on board, including the captain, didn't know about the thing, and I would hold myself up in there, and I would decide, I want to learn something about this. So now, there was a guitar in there, or something, you couldn't really call it a guitar. It was just a keyboard that had some strings on it, but, you know, you didn't know what the hell they were. And nobody aboard ship could help me with it. So I took it one day and I went, this thing, I can't call it a guitar almost. And I went, and that's what it sounded like. And so I took one note to ba 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 ba, and then I had another note which was terrible, but I tuned it until it sounded like something, mm-hmm. you know, something that you could listen to. And then I found another one and another. Now I had four strings that were related to each other. And somehow I was able to figure out enough to say that, well, that's a chord. That's a chord. And so now I went, chunk, 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 chunk. I began to sing. And so I, you know, I
new chord.
Had to do something else. And I had to find a different chord to go with where. And then I found not only that, with those four notes and that one chord, I could play 100 songs that I know of, you know. Oh boy, that was a discovery. I mean, I learned.
Were you entirely self-taught on the guitar?
Completely self-taught. I mean, once I had learned that thing that I knew about, that opened a whole new world. And of course, you know, I was picking up books and trying, you know, and learning a lot, you know, or if I'd see someone else with guitar, boy, I wouldn't let them off, you know. I'd be asking him a million questions, and it went on from there.
So when you got back from the war, you went to college?
When I got back from the war, and I went back to Brooklyn College, and I loved it. I loved it. It was such a, first of all, by any standard, it was a wonderful school. But I just loved it there. I just loved it.
And how about musically at Brooklyn College? Did you start?
Well, music. What happened? You know, also, I was very, very political minded, and so on, as a lot of kids in Brooklyn College were. So there were a lot of left wing or liberal or conscious people. And then after a while they'd say, hey, listen, we're having this meeting. Yeah, well, why don't you come and sing us a song or two? So I knew a song or two, so I, you know. And that's when I first began performing. And then, of course, you meet a lot more people. And it was also a time when you had a lot of people coming out of the army. Or the services, and there were a lot of people who were trying to get back into what they had been doing earlier, where they were writing music, they were performing music, they were responding to music, they were getting ba-ba-da-ba-ba-da-ba-da. And it was a very artistic community, as it were, and that was called People's Songs. And that involved Leonard Bernstein, who wasn't Leonard Bernstein,
right?
But he's Leonard Bernstein, you know? And all kinds of people, you know, and Paul Robeson, not necessarily big left winger, but people who were just, that's what they were doing, or trying to get into, or get back into, or, you know, so it was a very active thing. And there was a guy by the name of Lee Hayes who, he was a writer and a singer, sort of, an organizer. At any rate, he became head of People's Songs. And one day I got a postcard from him. I didn't know him. He said, "Dear Fred, remember, I think I even have that postcard still." Anyway, the postcard said, "Dear Fred, I hear that, you know, that you're a good singer. And, you know, why don't you come around and let's get acquainted." And that's how I met Lee Hayes. And then from Lee Hayes, that's how I met Pete Seeger. Because Pete was very active with People's Songs. And
so that was the beginning.
That was the beginning.
Of the Weaver.
Well, so no, I've begun to be doing a lot of singing with Pete.
Right.
And with Lee. It was a wonderful, and actually, all right, I'm going to come back to that.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was, while I was at Brooklyn College, I remember I got a job a summer job at a sort of a left-wing children's camp. And I was, you know, just a musical guy there, playing the guitar and whatever. You know, and sing some songs and teach some songs there. And Ronnie Gilbert was a gal who got a job up there working in the office, but a wonderful singer. And I knew her from People's Songs also. And we began singing a lot together, and she was a wonderful singer. And we remained very close. So now we had Lee Hayes, and here Lee Hayes is beginning to write some songs. Like, wasn't that eyes? It turns out Lee Hayes was the guy who was writing songs like that. He's from Arkansas. And it occurs to me that the songs that I was hearing on the phonograph were written by Lee Hayes. Said that it wasn't Benny Goodman. It was the Baptist church music that Lee was writing to. And that's where songs were coming from. And what Pete was doing was doing a lot of the early American songs, the histories. And there was Pete, and now there was Ronnie and Fred.
Mm-hmm.
And that was four of us. That was the Weavers.
Now, can you tell me?
And then.
Go ahead.
And then when the Weavers were now a group already, people would be coming up to me and saying, "You get all these wonderful songs that you guys sing, you know, they're Pete and Lee and Ronnie and me, blah, 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 blah." And you know, how do you do? Where do you get these things? And it never occurred to me that a lot of the songs that we were doing, I was bringing that kind of music. I was bringing a different kind of music into, and it had never occurred to me that I had some role, it was a big role too, in bringing all the Weavers stuff to us. Mm-hmm. Stuff that became the Weavers. Mm-hmm. So that was a huge, huge realization for me. Big realization.
Now I read that you started out as the No Name Quartet.
We started out as, you know, because what was happening that we were, oh yeah, what was happening that we were getting offers, you know, hey, can you, from groups, from Communist Party meetings, from churches, from this, you know, and we never refused anybody. And we did, we sang anyone who wanted to listen to us. We were very happy. And I was going to say
your
something.
Your name was the No Name Quartet?
Yeah, you know, so we needed a name, the No Name Quartet. We'd make every time we went somewhere, we, you know, we'd make up some kind of a name. But then we became the Weavers.
So tell us about
that. Because we were always saying, well, we have to get a name for this, you know, because that's what we're coming up with, crazy names constantly. Now, here I was at Brooklyn College, and at the time, I was an English major there, and I was taking a course in German drama. German drama. And then, in the course of it, I see we were assigned to read a play by Gerhard Hauptmann, who had just won a Nobel Prize for a play of his called The Weavers. And The Weavers was this play in which there were these weavers who were on strike and marching from one town to another singing big marching songs, you know, to, you know, et cetera, you know, militant songs. And that was our assignment. And I remember the next day, you know, I mean, I read it. And the next day, the Weavers were getting together, you know, for your weekly rehearsal. And I walked in there with a big smile, and I said, I think I have a name for us. What? And I said, how about The Weavers? And that's where we got the name.
So it had political significance as well.
Oh yeah.
Given the subject matter of the play.
Yeah, I like to stress it. But about that time, you know, is when the Weavers were appearing all over the place. We were doing interviews, and the first question any interview was, where did you get the name The Weavers? And before I had a chance to open my mouth, Pete said, oh, well, I read this play by Gerhard Hauptmann. Did you get that from Pete? Not that I was very shaken by that. And then the next thing that happened was, they said, where did you guys get the name The Weavers? And Lee Hayes says, Well, I got that from Gerhard Hauptmann. It's it's not the way it's supposed to be. And I've never said anything about that.
That's funny. So now here you are. You finally got the four of you together, but it wasn't exactly an immediate success.
Oh, it was.
But you had to struggle early on.
Oh, well, before that.
Before that, right.
But before we came up with the name The Weavers, and once we had to struggle with the name The Weavers, and once we had the name The Weavers, that's when we exploded. Mm-hmm. I mean,
Before that. Mm-hmm. You were at the Village Vanguard.
That's it.
You were talking about, I'll remind you, and you can correct me, you were talking about breaking up. It wasn't working out.
No.
You were going to go to graduate school in University of Chicago.
No, that was before.
That was before the Weavers.
Before the Weavers and before we.
So tell us about a little bit about that period when you were struggling and.
I'm talking now about before the Village Vanguard.
Right, exactly.
And yes, we were struggling. I remember walking into a rehearsal that we were having because we so enjoyed singing with each other. But I remember with such a vivid memory. Pete had a house down on, he was living in a house down on McDougal Street in New York, in Greenwich Village. And he had a wife and had a baby, a newborn baby. And so I really came in and I saw Pete. He was in the other room, he was just stretched out on a bed. He was so beaten. I said, Pete, you know, what's the matter? He said, well, I'm just sitting here thinking, I think I have to get a job in a factory. You know, I've got a family I have to support. And then, you know, Lee was writing, and he was getting some stories published, you know, here and there. And Ronnie was thinking of flying out to California to get a job in an office or something. And I had graduated from Brooklyn College and was accepted at the University of Chicago for some graduate work. What was just lying in front of us before desperation. And that's when came up with the idea of, let's try to see if we can get a job out of Max Gordon at Village Vanguard. Because Pete had worked there once before as a solo thing. So, you know, that we went, we auditioned down there. And he said, Max, some funny things happened here. We went to Max and said, okay, listen, why don't you come in next Wednesday and give us a audition, you know. And so we did, and apparently we did very well. I mean, nobody said, oh boy, this is the greatest thing ever happened.
Yeah.
Said, okay. You can come in here for a month, you know. First we did the audition. And then, it's kind of nice. Yeah, come in for a month. For 4 weeks. And we'll give you $200 for the week. $200 for the whole group. $50 a week we were working there. And I don't want a hamburger. And then Max came in one day when Pete was making a hamburger. No more hamburgers. And then what happened was, oh, no more hamburgers. So next time, come in. Right across the street was White Castle or whatever.
Yeah, it's White Castle or hamburgers.
You know, they were a nickel. And so we came over there. And we had paper bags that we ripped very loudly. And he said, what is that? And he's like, Max, we can't afford your prices for this thing. Let them have the hamburgers. So, yeah, so that was...
So that's the Village Vanguard.
That was the Village Vanguard, yeah.
So then how did you get from there to a recording contract?
Oh. So while we were down there, Gordon Jenkins was a big band leader. Anyway, he came down to Village Vanguard one night, and he just fell in love with us. And he was, every night he was down there, and if he didn't show up there, we figured he must be sick. We'd call his hotel, and sure enough, he was sick, you know. And he said, you know, I've got to record this group. I've got to, not only, you know, and of course he's got a whole slew of accompanists, you know, of accompanists and, you know, arrangers and stuff like that. And he said, but, you know, he said, look, I want you to come down there. I want you to listen so you get a sense of living and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And if they made a change, if they changed a note of what we did, forget it, he'd throw it out. He was a wonderful guy, just a wonderful guy. And not a political guy, he doesn't know, you know, but he knew what he was listening to, he knew what he was listening to. And he's just wonderful.
So tell us about when you first went to the recording studio so they could hear you. And there were a group of people listening to you.
Oh, yeah, that's something else. It came about a little bit different.
Sure.
At the time, Gordon was the big A&R man there. Because, you know, he's the biggest record seller in the United States. And the top man there was Dave Capp, who's, he and his brother were running Decca Records at the time. And Gordon was absolutely determined to bring us up there and play for him. So we go up there and you know, we play for Dave. And we played for him, and then we sang a song, you know, and then somebody else in the department, you know, would come up and, you know, listen, and after a while, just the whole place was listening to us. And when it got finished, and there's nothing more, and Gordon was there, you know, ready for, you know, for... But instead he got... From Dave said, well, that's what you, you know, we listen to you, you know, and, you know, I've had contact with every one of you, all four of us, one by one, in one way or another, you know, I've been acquainted with each of you and all of you. He said, and so I just have to say to you again, you know, you want to be good, or you want to be, what the hell was it? Oh God, I can't remember now. I don't know, but Lee Hayes gave him some kind of answer that just put him down there. And Gordonsfield, you know, he's always said, if I have to pay for it myself, you know, I have to record this. But anyway, so he came in, and the first thing he did, you know, he did some. Anyway, it's a fantastic arrangement, and it came out, and 5 minutes later it was coming out of every store.
That was your first hit?
Oh God, yeah, it was the first mega hit.
And what was the name? What was the name of that?
Yeah. Because yes. You know, Gordon picked up on the song, and but you know, we just put it in his lap. And you know, he remained a very, very good friend.
And so now you're going, all of a sudden, you are.
Oh, where?
Stars.
We're huge stars, huge stars. Then, you know, Goodnight Irene came along as part of it, and they got tired of listening to this, and then. And I remember when we finished that session. Never run across this before. When the orchestra just got up and applauded, which was oh boy.
So now you're big stars.
Now we're big stars.
So tell me, what does it feel like to be a big star? How did that change your life?
Well. Certainly changed Lee's life, because he discovered in his other world there was such a thing called room service. that was a big part of his life. And well, that's it, you know, we're big stars, and you know.
So now you're big stars, and you have Sena, Sena, Sena. You have Goodnight Irene. How did you go about selecting songs thereafter? Who decided what you were going to sing and what you were going to put on the record? How did that work out?
Well, Gordon. Gordon would take, you know, that was his job, to come up with songs, you know, he was a big A&R guy there, and everything he did was, you know, usually successful. So, you know, just going to keep doing successful things for us and for him.
So he would be basically the person he knew the songs that you were doing, he would select a song and say this. Oh, this
or you know, we would be coming up with some songs, right, and some ideas, and he would come in and he, better I, he'd come up with things. He was pretty good.
And I was asking you, sort of emotionally, psychologically, what does it feel like to be on top of the world musically?
Well, it felt very good. Felt very good in many ways. It allowed me to do some experimenting, and I think that some of the stuff that I came up with was quite remarkable. And I will immodestly say, pretty wonderful, some of the stuff I've come up with. Mm-hmm.
So tell me about the group dynamic. Was it a democracy? Was there a dominant player, how did you make decisions as a group?
Well, one of the things I think that was really quite remarkable about the group was that we were all so respectful of each other. One of the things that shows up several times, it shows up several times, several occasions, I can't remember, you know, which specifically, but I had to say to other singers or other musicians, I say, one of the biggest things you have to be paying attention to what you're hearing. The whole key to everything is you have to listen what the other singers are doing, and you have to make your adjustments to them. And whether it's to sing it louder than them, or sing it less than them, you really have to be listening to what the others are doing. And if you can't do that, you're in the wrong line of work. And that's such a key to what goes on. And even now, I'm not describing it well enough.
Mm-hmm. So now you're on top of the world. You've got these great songs. Did you feel pressure to follow up with the next song? What are we going to do next that is going to be
Well, that did
consistent?
Become a problem. It did become a problem. Because we were also going in some different directions a little bit. Little things like what emerged was a kind of feeling, well, with Ronnie I don't know, but I know that with Lee and me, who else is there? There was Lee Hayes and Pete, but that's not who we're talking about right now.
Mm-hmm.
But Lee Hayes and me, and Ronnie I don't know about, but she came at this a whole different area. Ronnie got into her feminist thing. It was with a lot of and it was kind of crazy too. I mean, to my mind, it was crazy. You know, because I would write a new song, for example, and I would automatically, if it was a women's song, I would send it off to Ronnie right away, and yeah, she'd just think. But after a while, I wouldn't send stuff to her anymore, because she would take it and she would rewrite it, and it was so bitter, and it was so angry, and it was so distorted, and it was so, you know, I finally had to say to Ronnie, I said, Ronnie, you know, you could, I don't really like what you, the tone of what you've been doing. And, you know, I'm not going to argue with you about the tone of it and the too much of what I hear. So I'm not going to try to talk you out of that at this point. But I will tell you one thing. I say, I don't care. Whatever it is you do, but the one thing you will not do, you will not get me to change my name to Fred Heller Person. And I was so proud of myself because I really hit that one on the head. Yeah, I will not change my name to Fred Heller Person.
So we were talking about pressure to come up with the next big hit, the next big thing. And you said you were heading off in different directions.
Yeah, we clearly were. We clearly were.
So how did you, was Gordon able to say, well, here?
No. This was almost, when Gordon was out of it for us, we weren't even recording anymore. Decca, wasn't recording anything of ours. Mm-hmm. It wouldn't be able to sell it anywhere.
So let's go back then a little bit. And so we want to talk about Joseph McCarthy.
Well, that was really like an atomic bomb, that is. But it exploded on us. It was in the June of, we finished our obligation to the Village Vanguard. And it was June, and now we were going our ways. Ronnie was going to California, and we had a baby, new baby there, and so on and so forth. But aside from that, it was time. We were all going, we had different things we wanted to do. We were clearly four separate people. Mm-hmm. Clearly four separate people. And what happened, that blacklist just shot, just exploded as a form of work.
So how did you find out?
We found out that no place would hire us for a club, mm-hmm. For a place they wanted to do concerts and this and that. And every concert was being picketed, and so on. And at the same time, I'd be waking up every morning and say, well, what am I going to do today? Well, the thing is that, so I decided, damn it, here I've been making a very nice living as a musician. And but I don't know a damn thing about music. It didn't occur to me. That's when I decided I wanted to build myself a little workshop. I built myself a little workshop. And I had Bob DeCormier, who was a very good friend of mine, a wonderful musician out of Juilliard, and mostly he was interested in, he really wanted to be a conductor for musical things. And then I had two women who were singers, actually who worked for Gordon Jenkins in his choruses and stuff. So those two and Bob DeCormier and me, I now had four people in a workshop, and come hell or high water, whatever happened for the Wednesday nights when we would get together, but I made sure that I always had a few new arrangements for things for a new song, or maybe we even have a new song, you know. And I so that's the smartest thing I ever did in my life. The smartest thing I've ever done in my life was to do this workshop for myself. On top of that, at the time...
So why did you think it was the smartest thing you ever did?
We'll come to it. That's okay. The next paragraph.
Okay, gotcha.
And at the same time, I was madly in love with someone. And here... had this workshop where I was making arrangements, and they were good arrangements, good vocal arrangements, and the singers loved what I was doing because it was fresh and it was new and it was, you know, and here I was in love, and never mind that I was broke, I mean, I wasn't broke then, but you know, I had no future. And so on. It was a terrible, terrible time. And yet it was the happiest time of my life. I can really say it was the happiest time of my life.
What a wonderful juxtaposition.
Yeah.
Now, were you called to testify before Congress? Do you recall?
I was a call. I didn't have to go to Washington. There was had to walk to the federal courthouse in New York, and you know what? And I didn't have anything to say to them. You know, they asked me a lot of stupid questions. Mr. Holman, I see here that you sang for the Communist Party, a meeting of the Communist Party. That's all I had to say, you know. I said, yeah, I sang for them. I sang for the meeting, so what? Nobody blew up the White House, nobody.
You were cut off from your record?
Cut off from my records, cut off from many jobs, so, you know, for my reputation, who the hell was it coming close to me? You know?
And so then the Weavers broke up. There was nothing to do.
Yeah, there was nothing to do. We couldn't do anything, you know. Ronnie went out to California. She went out to California.
So then tell us about how you were able to resume your career as a Weaver. You had other things going on, but now the Weavers get back together.
Well, we weren't. There was nothing to get together about.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we couldn't go back to Carnegie Hall. You know.
But at some point you did.
Well, and that had to do with Harold.
Harold Leventhal.
Yeah.
Tell us about Harold.
Well, Harold is just such a he's such a special person.
Let me change the topic a little bit, and since we are the Weston Historical Society, let's talk a little bit about Weston. So you came to Weston. What motivated you to come to Weston in the first place?
Okay, what motivated me to come? It was around the Alice Delamar thing, and Alice, like to have interesting people surrounding her. And these friends of mine were interesting people. And she was a friend of Will Geer. I mean, my friends there were a couple. And they were friends of Will Gear, who was a very good friend of mine also. And Will got blacklisted and you know, from Hollywood. And then he came to New York, and well, he couldn't get any work right away here in New York. But he, he got together, you know, theatrical people. I can't even remember who the hell they were anymore. But he called me, and he was staying in a loft down on 27th Street. Get together on weekends, and he put on shows, and he and I would be putting on plays together. Anybody, you know, would come in, walk in, and Woody Guthrie would come by, and this one, and all kinds of people, and if my memory wasn't completely shot, you know, all kinds of other wonderful figures I could tell you were coming by. And it, really, anybody who wanted to come by had something to do or sing or tell a joke or whatever. It was just a, you know, a swell little thing. Anyway, these people who were in this loft also, you know, would say to me, "Hey, Fred, listen, you're going to come up to I can't even remember what it was called at the time. Okay. But we would come up here to Newtown Turnpike, as it were, you know, for the weekend. And I would come up, and all kinds of people would be here. Lotta Lenya, for example, you know, would be up here half the time. and a movie star or something, or a writer. It was always interesting. And now Gene was you see the thing I have on the wall here?
The painting, yes, that you painting, showed me that painting.
That right. Was a painting by Gene Watts. That was the Gene of this couple. and it's a wonderful painter, delightful, and she's so full of humor and let's see. So anyway, so I would come up here, and I would take a walk down Newtown Turnpike, which wasn't paved, by the way, at the time. But I was always so touched by saying, "My God, this is only an hour away from New York, or from Greenwich Village, where I lived." And it was so different. It was so different. And of course, I was broke by now. I didn't have any money. So the idea of my ever coming up here to live was so remote. But that's how I happened to know this area, you know, to first come up to this area and fall in love with it. And then actually, I'm trying to think that I remember the Weavers did come up here, and it was about this time or maybe earlier, probably, when the Weavers came up, and we did a concert at in Westport, not in Weston, but in what's the biggest school there?
Playhouse.
Hmm?
Staples.
High School. Yeah, we did a concert at Staples.
Mm-hmm.
Did not go down historically. Harold was here. He bought a house right by Cobb's Mill Inn.
Okay.
Just the next door to Cobb's Mill Inn. And he, you know, bought a house there. And I did stop at a real estate office up here And I said, look, I'm looking for, you know, a small house, and then came from that weekend, I got a call from the real estate person. I said, I think we have a house for you. I said, oh, good, you know, because I'm coming up here for next Sunday for it. Fine, you know. Mm-hmm. So that's how I came up here, and I booked this house, blah, 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 and I mm-hmm. bought it. And, you know, right away I moved in here. And now, of course, right, and then we had a baby, Susan and I. Euclid shook.
He did?
Huh? Right. He shook, and did you ever?
That name is not familiar.
It's not familiar. Oh, because he was a justice of the peace up here,
mm-hmm.
and he's the one that married us.
Okay.
So that's how I happened to get here. Well, once we were living here, it was a time when they had Memorial Day, you know, weekends and so on. And so you go down to the downtown and people marching and so on. And towards the end of it, end of the parade, it was all kinds of, you know, groups and, you know, marching and their thing, marching in this parade. And it was something, one of the things that was striking here, I'd been coming up from New York, and here was this parade, and I don't know whether we decided to march in it or not, but it was a parade of people saying, you know, we're marching for peace, and we don't like any of this peace from the war in Vietnam, and you know, we're used to. It was so nice to be marching in a parade and not to be hearing, Dad, why don't you go back to Red Russia? We felt so comfortable. We said, yeah, we're in the right place. It really put a good mark on this area.